Many large and lethal reptiles have existed on our planet, from ferocious crocodilians to giant theropod dinosaurs. Compared to these toothy monsters, turtles don't have nearly the same deadly reputation. Around the world, these gentle, slow-moving reptiles are beloved and protected by many, with several species kept as household pets. It's hard to imagine turtles being so dangerous, but there was a time on our planet when giant carnivorous turtles would have sent chills down your spine. These terrifying animals lived during the late Cretaceous period, between 80 and 74 million years ago. The late Cretaceous is best known for its gigantic dinosaurs, like Tyrannosaurus, but just a few million years earlier, sea turtles were also experiencing a trend of gigantism. Several species grew to enormous body sizes, but the largest was Archelon ischyros, a leathery-shelled monster that dwarfed any species of turtle ever discovered. At its largest, Archelon measured 4.6 meters from head to tail and 4 meters from flipper to flipper. It also weighed up to 3 metric tons, which is more than the heaviest great white shark ever recorded. Despite its massive build, Archelon's body was still moderately hydrodynamic, mostly due to the unusual structure of its upper shell, or carapace. Most modern turtle shells are rigid and made out of tough bone. These firm shells act like modified rib cages, protecting their vital organs, and are typically covered by plate-like scales called scutes. Land-dwelling turtles usually have taller shells, which they can duck inside to hide from predators, while sea turtles tend to have flatter shells. However, Archelon didn't have this kind of heavily armored shell. While it did have bony elements, they were relatively thin and overlain by soft, leathery tissue, similar to leatherback sea turtles today. This provided Archelon with a more streamlined body plan, which made it more buoyant and hydrodynamic. Archelon probably wasn't breaking any speed records, but it could propel itself through the water with surprising efficiency. Rather than its speed, what made Archelon a fearsome predator during the late Cretaceous was its powerful, crushing beak. Archelon's skull was very elongated, measuring up to a meter, and its jaws were strong enough to smash through bones and exoskeletons alike. This predatory adaptation allowed Archelon to bite through the shells of hard-bodied animals, like crustaceans and mollusks, some of which could get very large. Bacchylites, for example, may have occasionally been food for titans like Archelon. Not all bacchylites were especially large, some measuring only 7 centimeters long, but the biggest species stretched up to 2 meters from the ends of their tentacles to the tips of their strangely shaped shells. Like other ammonite cephalopods, the interiors of their shells were divided into chambers, separated by walls known as septa. With these septa, bacchylite shells could withstand greater pressures deeper in the water column, and they also made their shells more resistant to predators by reinforcing its structure. But Archelon was no normal predator. With its formidable beak, it may have crushed the shells of bacchylites or other mollusks and exposed the soft tissue hidden underneath. Despite possessing such power, it's also likely that Archelon often chose to pursue easier prey, including soft-bodied creatures such as jellyfish and squid. As a giant predator, Archelon became a dominant force in one of the most vibrant marine ecosystems in the prehistoric world. During the late Cretaceous, much of North America was flooded by a warm, shallow sea called the Western Interior Seaway. This majestic body of water formed due to tectonic subduction around 100 million years ago. Back then, the Farallon Plate was slowly sliding under the North American Plate, creating vast mountains in the west. But it also warped part of the lithosphere downwards. This created a shallow depression that ran down the length of North America, from the Arctic Ocean all the way to the Gulf of Mexico. Sea levels were already high at that time, so it wasn't long before this depression filled with water and turned into a shallow sea. Soon, the warm, nutrient-rich waters of the southern part of the seaway were attracting all kinds of marine organisms, including primitive reef builders like rudest bivalves. Colonies of these animals constructed massive three-dimensional habitats along the seafloor, which supported more complex animals like marine reptiles, fish, mollusks, and crustaceans. Northern parts of the seaway had more modest biogenic structures, but still included bryozoans, oysters, and sponges. These attracted foraging predators like Archelon. Using its hard beak, Archelon may have dug through sediments and biogenic structures, looking for fish and tasty mollusks to smash in its jaws. Of course, Archelon wasn't the only predator enjoying the natural biodiversity of the Western Interior Seaway. In those same waters, Archelon faced constant competition from other hunters, foragers, and scavengers. Some of its direct competitors were predatory fish, plesiosaurs, and even a strange Mesozoic bird called Hesperornis. During the late Cretaceous, this flightless seabird was a common predator in shallow water ecosystems, including the Western Interior Seaway. Hesperornis didn't have functional wings, but it did have powerful legs and a streamlined body, which it used to dive and hunt underwater. Cutting through the waves like a rocket, Hesperornis could chase down and catch even the most evasive prey items, thanks in part to its distinctive grooved teeth. Unlike the teeth of other animals, which have individual sockets, Hesperornis's teeth rested in grooves along its entire lower jaw and the back part of its upper jaw. These teeth were pointy and curved slightly backward, making them perfect for grasping slippery animals like schooling fish. Though it mostly ate fish, Hesperornis may have occasionally hunted other animals, like soft squid. Hesperornis and Archelon probably hunted in the same ecosystems, sometimes competing for similar prey animals. But these seabirds were the least of Archelon's worries. Along with so many prey animals, the Western Interior Seaway was also home to an incredible variety of predators. To some degree, Archelon was resistant to predation thanks to its size and protective carapace. Most mid-level carnivores, like predatory fish, weren't strong enough to contend with this giant sea turtle, but there were much larger carnivores lurking in the deep. Among the deadliest at that time were massive marine reptiles called mosasaurs. These apex predators were fast and powerful swimmers that attacked almost anything in the sea. Of the giant mosasaurs, Tylosaurus was probably the largest in the Western Interior Seaway, stretching an astonishing 15 meters long. It was also a highly advanced mosasaur, with a streamlined body and an elongated tail for efficient propulsion. Tylosaurus was an aggressive and ravenous predator. Fortunately, its stomach contents are pretty well documented by paleontologists, showing a great variety of prey. This voracious eater consumed other mosasaurs, along with plesiosaurs, sharks, fish, squid, ammonites, seabirds like Hesperornis, and even giant turtles. Fossil evidence shows that Tylosaurus at least consumed the second largest turtle of all time, known as Protostega. While Protostega was smaller than Archelon, this massive sea turtle could still reach lengths of up to 4 meters. It's not definitively known whether Tylosaurus preyed on Archelon as well, but it's all too plausible that our favorite turtle was on the menu too. While large predators like Tylosaurus prospered in the Western Interior Seaway, smaller predators like Squalicorax also succeeded. Known as the crow shark, Squalicorax had serrated, curved teeth, adapted for slicing flesh and scavenging, reminiscent of the modern-day tiger shark. Unlike apex predators, Squalicorax likely hunted smaller fish, ammonites, and juvenile marine reptiles. But it may have also fed on the carcasses of dinosaurs or large reptiles that fell into the sea. In fact, Squalicorax tooth marks have even been found on the bones of pterosaurs, like Pteranodon. This opens up a curious possibility that these strange sharks could snatch prey out of the air by surprising them from below. This strategy is sometimes found in modern sharks, like great whites, who can leap 3 meters out of the water when hunting seals. It's also possible that Squalicorax simply attacked Pteranodon while it was diving for fish or scavenged their carcasses. Many fascinating creatures coexisted with Archelon, including the very small and the very strange. Barnacles, for example, may have colonized Archelon's gigantic back, or perhaps its flippers and skin, creating a unique microhabitat that expanded alongside its host. This interaction is a form of commensalism, and it's seen amongst modern-day whales, manatees, and sea turtles. The barnacles benefit from being transported through nutrient-rich waters, while the host is usually not harmed. However, if barnacle loads become excessive, they can occasionally cause drag or irritation of the skin. Amongst a beautiful variety of marine life, Archelon thrived in the Western Interior Seaway. But unfortunately, it would not last beyond the late Cretaceous. Its downfall actually began long before the end Cretaceous boundary, which wiped out the dinosaurs. As the seaway progressively closed and forced organisms into fragmented habitats, Archelon struggled for space. It would have faced greater competition from its natural rivals and predators. While few creatures could successfully prey on an adult Archelon in the sea, their eggs and hatchlings were mostly defenseless on the shore and may have been easy hunting for many predators, including dinosaurs like troodontids. It may have also had trouble adjusting to the cooling temperatures of the late Cretaceous, which began to favor animals with better thermoregulation. Around 74 million years ago, Archelon finally went extinct. Luckily, some turtles did survive the Cretaceous, eventually diverging into the many turtle species we treasure today. Remarkable as these animals may be, none of them quite compare to that rare giant of the late Cretaceous, the largest turtle our planet has ever known.